Good evening. Lord be with you. Well, looking at this picture, we see a tower and a basin. We may not see this picture in our home, but definitely in our toilet, somewhere in our home, we will often see a basin and a tower. Why do I know that? Because I do house chores. And for us to do house chores, there will always be a basin somewhere and a tower somewhere. A simple tower and a basin can tell us the mind of Christ. And these two items do not just remind us of a particular incident that happened in the upper room. They also tell us about God's mysterious way in the world. On the night where Jesus was betrayed, he gave one object lesson through the tower and the basin. What was he trying to teach us? Some of us who have been attending church for a long time, like myself, may no longer be surprised by this story. After all, it has been told many times on Maundy Thursday services. The image of Jesus on bended knee washing the disciples' feet may no longer cause a flutter in our hearts. The story is here, but we may no longer see it, and it may no longer impress us. So what if Jesus wrapped a towel around his waist and poured water into the basin? I get the bottom line. It's a lesson on humility. So can we get this service over and done with? But my friends, what if it is more than a lesson on human humility? What if it's a lesson on God's humility? Would we dare come closer to relook at the exalted God who bends to wash our feet? Come closer, a little bit more closer, because it may expose our pride and our self-assurance. But come nonetheless, come with me on this journey of reflection and travel with me as one of the participants in the story. The Apostle John, who wrote this passage, is concerned that we understand the significance of this story. First, he tells us that the hour has come. Huh? What hour? Definitely not Earth hour, where we shine a light on the climate action that our planet needs desperately. No, not that kind of hour. This hour refers to the decisive time approaching for Christ to finish up his earthly ministry and then return to his Father. As Christ approaches this hour of returning back to his Father, he wasted no time to demonstrate his love for his very own to the uttermost. Now, this is not a story about a great man who stooped low to do a low-grade task in order to inspire his followers to be humble. It's not a TED Talk that's so famous nowadays. Everybody go to YouTube, you know, they are so inspired by TED Talk. It's not a TED Talk of show and tell so that top management knows how to gain the support of their employees. No. The tower and the basin tells us all about what God does through Christ. As Jesus took off the outer clothing and wrapped a tower around his waist, he became for us the image of the invisible God. Suddenly, the invisible God was made manifest. And there in the room, God himself came on bended knee, washing feet. Well, this last meal might have happened in a private place, a private home, and in a secret place. And that's why there's no slaves in view to perform the lowly task of washing feet. Now, Christ did not ask who will do it. He took action. He took the initiative to get up, take off, tie around, pouring, washing, wiping. God Himself made manifest on bended knee, washing feet. Peter cannot behold this. It embarrassed him so much that he tried to stop Jesus. If there is a song that I can attach to Peter's reaction, it would have been Chen Tian Wen's Unbelievable, Stunned Like Vegetable. What is significant is not that Christ will wash dirty feet. Beyond that, He cleanses the impurity of the soul. What is significant is not that Christ would carry a towel and a basin. Beyond that, He allowed Himself to be humiliated by carrying our sins. What is significant is not that Christ lay aside His garment. Beyond that, He laid down His life. And this is scandalous. This is God in action. The tower and the basin tells us that God condescended to us. Now, if I were to say to you that that person was condescending to me, this would not have been a compliment. Because those who act in a condescending way always look down on us with their long and important noses, right? That's what, you know, you are so condescending actually mean, right? You look down on me, 你瞧不起我, right? Or you see me no up. Condescending people think that they are big people and then treat us like little people. But Christian theologians use the language of condescension in a different way when it is related to Christ. God condescends to us not to remind us of our smallness, not to remind us of our insignificance, not to remind us of our worthlessness. Rather, He steps down to lift us up. He's not a God who watches from a distance and folds His arm. A story was told of this Bible school student from the Philippines who was rather disturbed by the condition of the male toilet. It seems to always be neglected in the cleaning routine. And so when nothing was done to eliminate the filth and the smell, the student took matters into his own hands. He complained to the principal of the school. And a little while later, the student noticed that the problem was resolved. So he was really very happy. Ah, finally, someone did something about it. But lo and behold, he saw with amazement that the man with the mop and the pail in hand was none other than the principal himself. Later, the student commented, "I thought the principal would call a janitor, but he cleaned the toilet himself. It was a major lesson to me on being a servant, and of course, it raised a question in my own mind as to why I haven't taken care of the problem." God is not unlike that principal. He deliberately dresses down to reach us. He dismounts from His high horse, dirties His hand, and reaches down in mercy to lift. The Bible says He lifts up the poor from the dust, and then the needy from the garbage dump. Christ took the divine initiative to wash feet, and this task is not underneath Him. Why is that so, you might ask? That's because Jesus Christ has always been secure. If you look at the text, it tells us that He has always been secure because He's always conscious of His divine origin, His divine destiny, and also His divine power. In other words, Christ has always known where he comes from, where he goes, where he is going, and what he possesses. Now, so here is the mind of Christ. The mind of Christ says this, that no task and no person is ever below our dignity. When we know our God-given identity, when we know our God-given destiny, and when we know our God-given resources. When we know who we belong to, when we are familiar with whose we are, when we stay secure in who we belong to, no job is too low for us to engage in. My friends, too often, the lack of this awareness and our self-absorption are two reasons why we do not dismount from our high horses for the sake of others. Right? The lack of this awareness and self-absorption. In many ways, the Apostle John shows us that we are so much like the disciples who were gathered in the upper room that night. Hours before, the disciples had argued with one another about who's going to be the greatest. Their minds were preoccupied with dreams of promotions and seats of honor in the coming kingdom. Hooray, Jesus is establishing a kingdom. I wonder who's going to get the best seat. And then they were also jealous, worried. What if one of the peers is going to outdo me and claim the best place? And so they argue. Hours before, they argue who is going to be the best, and hours later, they would betray and desert Jesus because of greed and fear. Don't you think we are like the disciples in many ways? Prone to play favorites and choose sides. Prone to promote ourselves in case we don't get recognized or applauded. Are we prone to pretend that someone else will do the job we do not want to do? And if we are asked to do it, we contest and then we complain, Sienna, why me? Ask him lah. Hey, not fair, yeah? Pay someone to do it. Hey, I come first. I deserve this. Don't ask me to move my seat lah. I belong here, this seat belongs to me. Not another sai gang. Aren't we prone to contest and complain? And aren't we prone to faithlessness? I look at the tower and the basin and I stand amazed. They tell me that God condescended despite the way we are. Christ always knew the kind of disciples, the kind of men the disciples were, in the same way that he knows us. He diagnoses their childishness. You can see that in verse 33. And he diagnoses our childishness. He sees through their cowardice in the same way Christ sees through our lack of courage. He is familiar with their disloyalty. And in the same way, Christ sees through our disloyalty. Christ knows us completely, and yet he does not despise or shame us. Instead, he protects and serves us. He plans for our future. And he offers to share life with us. And that's why he said, unless you let me wash you, you will have no part in me. Life. He offers life to people like us. Christ not only washed the dirt off the disciples' feet, he acted in self-sacrificial love to also remove the impurity of our pride and of our sin. So what if we know all this? Because even as I was preparing this, I remember hearing this sermon spoken to me. So what if we know all this? Well, my friends, I believe that the tower and the basin are images for Christian living. It is meant for application, not just for listening. The tower and the basin calls us to walk in the self-giving love of Jesus Christ. It is not an instruction for us to hold a ceremony from time to time to literally wash one another's feet, because we can wash feet and miss the point. There is so much more in this image. Neither is Christ asking us to repeat his sacrifice on the cross. It is done. It is finished. We cannot add to it. But Christ's calling is for us to follow him and to imitate the example of his self-giving love, his self-giving service in everyday living. And I'm sure that you and I all occupy places of influence, whether it's in school, at home, at our workplace, we all occupy places of influence. How are we demonstrating this self-giving love and this self-giving services where we are? Do we go by and go through social barriers? Do we go lower to minister to those whom we consider as our natural inferiors? Do we leap over boundaries of class distinctions? Do we stoop in love for those whom God has redeemed in the family of God? Do we look for opportunities to be a servant for the last, the least, and the lost? Or is this a job for someone else? Do we stop stereotyping that Indians always cook smelly curries and that PRCs defecate in public? Do we serve people like this? About a few months ago, I was running, and I was running at West Coast, you know, West Coast Highway. It's lots of trucks and traffic. And then I was running from Clementi all the way to West Coast and observing the pavement. Suddenly, lo and behold, there was an elderly woman in front of me. She stooped down, and her lower pants was actually pulled down. And she was in a position as though, you know, she was defecating. And smack in between her are two trucks. And the drivers and the helpers, they were at one side smoking away, taking a breather. And this elderly woman, she was just mimicking the motion as though she was about to pee or to poo. Now, I was horrified. All I had was my running gear and my track shoes. I did not have a towel with me. And when I saw her, the first thing that came to my mind is, what if the police were to stop by? She's going to be arrested. She's going to be like hauled all the way to the police station. And so I went up to her, and then, you know, just using my body, I tried to cover her. And I say, Auntie, you can't do this in public. Right? It's not good for you. You know, stand up. Don't poo here. All right, lift up your pants. Let me bring you somewhere, because it was very near to the residential area. I said, let me help you up, pull up the pants, and let me bring you somewhere where you can do this in the toilet. See, so many people looking for you. It's not good. And then she was groaning away as though in deep pain, as though she was having a stomach pain, but actually there wasn't anything coming out. And so then I was persuading her. I was trying to lift her up, but she was just too heavy for me. And after a while, you know, because she refused to cooperate with me, I could just basically tell her that you must be careful, because the trucks were coming fast and furious. And I said, you know, do not let any of this truck knock you down. Yeah. And my mom was wondering, why aren't the men helping? Could it be that she's demented and they have seen her here before? Could it be that she misunderstood that this is her home toilet when actually it's public space? So many questions ran past my mind. And I wonder, what would you respond if you were to see something like this? Will we take out our handphone and take a picture, stomp it, or share it on Facebook? I don't know. I remember, you know, sharing this through SMS with somebody, and then that somebody responded, must be a PRC, because they like to do something like this in public. And my heart was broken. What if it's not a PRC? What if it's somebody's grandma, someone who is from the Methodist Church, or someone who is, you know, a grandma of a fellow brother and sister of another denomination? Or what if she's not even, yeah, someone related to us in the family of God, but made in the image of God nonetheless? What would the tower and the basin call us to do when we meet with a situation like this, to strangers, to people that we do not know? Serving people in self-giving love must be a very demanding task. I wouldn't say that it is easy. I am admitting that it is a demanding task. What shall drive us to it and keep us to it? How can we keep doing this? I believe the secret of success, of staying at this, going in self-giving love and self-giving service, is found in verses 13 and 14. Jesus said, "You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so I am. If I then, the Lord and the teacher, wash your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet." Interesting, a play of word here. You call me teacher and Lord. And then he said, if I, the Lord and teacher. In thinking and speaking to Jesus Christ, the disciples have always been inclined to call him teacher first, and then Lord second. However, in speaking to them about himself, Christ reversed the order. First Lord, then teacher. Now the change in word seemed to be a little bit small and insignificant, yeah? But it reversed the whole meaning of the text. You see, my friends, all too often we come to Christ as teacher to hear what he has to say and then make up our mind as to whether we will agree with his teaching before we carry out his commands. But this is not the proper way for believers who behave in the school of Christ. Christ reversed the order that we may know that we should come to him first as Lord. We should make up our mind in advance to obey him and to do whatever he teaches us as we listen to him as teacher. He is Lord first, teacher second. If the Lord is the Lord over our lives, then the secret of being right with God is not a passive, it's not simply a passive keeping of rules and regulations. No. If we are true disciples of Jesus Christ, if we are true believers of Jesus Christ, then we will increasingly feel prompted to treat others as Christ treats us. His powerful example will become the motivation for us in our Christian behavior. Has Christ forgiven us? Then we will stand ready to forgive others. Has Christ washed our feet? Then we will seek to wash the feet of others. Has Christ laid down his life for us? Then we ought to be ready to be inconvenient for the sake of others. Did we experience God's gentleness when Christ worked on our weaknesses? Then we ought to imitate his method without appearing superior when we confront somebody else's fault. Do we want true power? Then loosen the fist, change the tone, demonstrate love and humility. see the tower and the basin. They tell us the mind of Christ. They inform us about the way of God. The bottom line is not about human humility. It starts with God's humility. God is condescended to us despite the way we are, and He leaves us an example that we may do as He did. Having experienced the grace of our Lord, He now turns to us and He asks for our allegiance. Will you renew your vow to imitate His humility and service and sacrifice? Will you be willing to soak in a lesser role for the benefit of someone else? Will you deepen your loyalty to Him? Let me end with a poem by Ruth Calkin, and I tweeted it a little bit to apply to our context. It says, "You know, Lord, how I serve You with great emotional passion and in the limelight. You know how eagerly I speak for You at task force and committee meetings. You know my excitement when I promote a fellowship group, and You know my genuine enthusiasm at Bible study. But how would I react, I wonder, if You pointed to a basin of water and asked me to wash the calloused feet of a bent and wrinkled old woman, day after day, month after month, in a room where nobody sees?"